Amazing. Well, thank you so much. I just want to say that I am so grateful for the opportunity. It was a little bit last minute. So for me to put together a presentation for you today was a bit of choosing what I wanted to share. So I think that's always a beautiful challenge to face as a researcher, and I'm grateful for the lesson. And I am from Costa Rica. I did my bachelor's degree in honors sociology and human rights in Canada. And then I came back to Costa Rica to do a master's in Latin American studies. And the accumulation of this research I have been doing since 2012. And what I am going to present to you today is a little bit of my findings and my inspiration for the sex work rights movement in Latin America. And the empowerment of sex workers that they have done themselves by organizing themselves and by fighting for their rights. And this is part of a thesis research by the National University of Costa Rica and the Institute of Latin American Studies that encourages constantly all the time to be critical in our approach and to find the ways in which our history from Latin America is being shaped here from Latin America. And from that perspective, testimony and testimonials are one of the most powerful tools that we have to understand the realities that certain people live. So I want to share with you the testimonies of what I consider to be the birth of the sex workers movement in Latin America, here in Brazil, where I'm actually living at right now. And I'm going to go ahead and share that. All right, amazing. So these are some of the ideologies and challenges and achievements of the sex workers' social movement and the fight for their rights. And as I said, it's inspired by their collective work. When we talk about sex work, we have these three ideal lines, right? And it's the abolition line, which is sex workers are victims. This only happens because they're being extorted by third-party individuals like pimps or other people, and they have absolutely no rights, no consciousness, no absolutely anything. Then we have the regulationism line, which is where sex work is regulated and it is recognized, and there are pros and cons to this. Some of the pros that can come to this is that then women can access all kinds of labor benefits, for example, for their work. They cannot be they receive violence from the police because of our work that is legal, right? So this gives them protection as well. Some of the things that are not so positive, for example, is that in some cases and some countries where they have applied this rule, they bring in the sex workers and they force them to take these tests for STIs or HIV. And then if a sex worker comes up with some sort of STI or HIV, then they publish her picture, which is a complete violation to her privacy of health, et cetera. And it makes things difficult for them. They also have to carry like these IDs sometimes, or they can only work and stay in particular times. So then they're like prohibited to be walking out on the streets in other parts where it's not where they're doing their sex work. So it can become a little bit quite controlling of them. And then we have the prohibition, which just makes it illegal. This is the system, for example, in the United States, and it has serious cultural consequences, not only for the United States and the sex workers in the United States, but also for Latin American and Latin American women that migrate to the United States. What we have here, what I wanted to share with you today, it is the movements, the social movements of sex workers in Brazil. Because this is where basically the consciousness of sex work started based on my research. So we're talking about these three associations that we're gonna talk about here today. We're gonna go over them quickly and just look at some of the work that they are doing and why this work is important. And again, what I want us to keep in mind is that the importance of this work is to highlight that rights, human rights, come from fights that people do at a grassroots level. human rights don't come from declarations that are signed by people, you know, because we have had these declarations that are signed, some countries sign them, some people don't, and even countries that sign them, we still have human rights violations. So the ones that make sure that we keep human rights on a scope that they are clean, that they are clear, and that we're making progress are usually social movements and interested populations that are fighting for their rights. So by looking a little bit at this history, it allows us to see that sex workers are not, you know, a generalized populations who are victims or who are whores or who are, you know, just this negative stain on our societies, but rather they are women who had choices and they chose sex work and one of those choices, and then they are working to empower themselves through sex work. So let's keep that in mind as we go through. I want to start with this amazing, inspiring woman, Gabriela Leche. She died sadly in 2013, and she was the president and founder of the sex workers movement in Brazil. In 1969, when Brazil had a dictatorship, she was a sociology student at the University of Sao Paulo. She did not finish her career in sociology, and she moved on to be a sex worker in Boca do Lixo in Sao Paulo, which is a Bohemian area of Belo Horizonte. Now, then she moved to a Bohemian area of Belo Horizonte in Minas Gerais, which is another state of Brazil. And then she moved to Vila Mimosa, which is the famous prostitution area in Rio de Janeiro. And in 1979, she organizes the first demonstration against police repression. This is still with the dictatorship. So she is going up against the dictatorship, against the military, and putting her body on the line to demonstrate against police repression of sex workers. In 1987, she creates the first national meeting in Rio de Janeiro and the creation of the Brazilian Network of Prostitutes. So what happened? A couple of years before 1987, in 1986, there's an organization of like a convention that is created in Brazil for all these others, right? So people that lived in favelas, people that lived in the margins of society. And one of the women that were organizing it, she invited Gabriela Leche and some of her sex worker friends to come along. And then at the end of the convention, when they were all like, oh, does anybody want to say something? You know, Gabriela got up and she was like, hi, my name is Gabriela Leche and I'm a prostitute. And the whole crowd was like, oh my God, you know? And this moment in history is repeated along many areas of the world. You know, in 1986, this is happening in the United States when Margot St. James also gets up and says, hey, I'm a sex worker. And it just identifies a moment in our history where a certain group in a population say, hey, I exist, I am here, this is what I do, and I am not ashamed. And this is very important because breaking this silence allows us to fight injustices, stigmas, allows us to fight for rights that are being overlooked. So this is a very, very important moment, and it leads to her, you know, starting this whole politicization and organization that then ends in the 1987 first national meeting in Rio de Janeiro and the creation of the Brazilian Network of Prostitutes. Now, I use the word prostitutes, I just want to make it clear, when I'm talking about associations or groups of sex workers that have reivindicated the word prostitute as a positive word. And then there are associations in the world, for example, the National Network of Sex Workers, the Network of Sex Workers in Latin America, that do not use the word prostitute. And then for them, we will refer as sex worker, right? Because it is their right to choose how they want to be referred to. So moving on, this is a picture of this beautiful gathering of women, and it was called Mulher da Vida, É Preciso Falar, Woman of Life. It is necessary that you speak, up. And I think as women, this is so important, and it's something that I think we can all relate to in a way, right? When we look back, especially this week, at the history of women's rights, it has been important for women to get up and say something and say, this is not right, this is not okay. The Me Too movement, it connects to all of these different worlds, you know, the necessity for people to get up and speak up and say their truth. So I really love this picture. It's very pixelated and old, but it was the one picture that I have in my research, and I just love to see it happening. And you can see the date a little bit here, 1987. So Gabriela Leche, 1987, they create the foundation. 1988, they create a newspaper that is called Beijo da Rua. This is so big, right? Because it's sex workers are gathering together to create a newspaper to share not only with the sex work community, but with the rest of society to talk about and demystify sex work. And this is just like beautiful and visionary work. In 1989, they create the Second Congress of Sex Workers, which is sex work and AIDS. In 1992, they founded DaVida, which is like the main first organization for sex work in Brazil. In 2005, they founded DASPU, which is a little for Das Putas, which means like for the sex workers. And it is a fashion, fashion without shame. And it creates all these fashion clothes that they sell. And with this money, they're able to fund their organization here in Brazil. Also, they invite sex workers to come and be part of the fashion show, which allows sex workers also to be empowered in their self-esteem and to be part of a movement also that is telling them, you know, that what they are doing is not something that deserves shame or violence from society, but on the contrary, that is brave. It's brave work, and that it allows them to cover for the expenses that they may have in their lives and their children and families. So I really love this idea of creating DASPU. In 2010, she actually ran for candidate for the federal deputy in the Brazilian Congress. And in 2011, thanks to her work and to her demonstrations and organizing, they created the Gabriela Leche Law, proposed by the federal deputy, Jean Willis, which differentiates sex work from exploitation. Now, why is this important, right? Ever since sex work has, been sort of like a social awareness, so we've had sex work all throughout history. This is not going to be the time for me to walk you through that history, but you can email me directly if you have some desire to look at that history. But we've had different groups in society that is, oh, it's not okay, or yes, that is okay, and why is that okay? And it's a constant debate that we have had through sex work. But one of the main ideas that have been pushing the rights of sex worker aside is saying that all sex work is trafficked work, and all trafficking leads to sex work, right? And it's very important to make that difference. When we're talking about sexual trafficking or trafficking of people for slavery or forced work, or, you know, to sell body parts, for example, in the black market, you know, this is very, very different from a woman waking up one day and saying, these are the options that I have available to me, and I'm going to choose this one because it makes me more money, or because X, Y, Z reason that women may have. Many of the reasons why women choose sex work, based on my research, is the economic advantages. A lot of it is the freedom in time. You know, you work at night, you're with your family during the day, you choose your own schedule. A lot of women also choose it because it's a sense of liberty. A lot of women also choose it because it allows them to have a different perspective of sex that they had. You know, some women in sex work have been sexually abused. Many women in the world are sexually abused and they do not turn to sex work. So there are many myths in the pool of sex work that we could talk about for hours and demystify and discuss. And I think what's more important is to hear what sex workers are talking about themselves. So by changing and creating a difference between exploitation as sex work, it allows us to say, no, not all trafficking is sex work. So why is this important? Because then, for example, organizations like the USAID, you know, which is an organization from the United States that give money to other countries to work on, you know, social causes or health or et cetera, they would say, okay, we're going to give X amount of money to Brazil have a fight against HIV, but you need to take out from all your organizations your help to sex work, because by helping sex workers, you're promoting HIV. You know, by helping sex workers, you're promoting trafficking of people. And this is when we see how one idea, you know, pushed in one direction and still using the stigma that we have against sex workers can leave a big population of women who are fighting, who are safe, who know more about safe sex practices than most women do, you know, on this phase of marginalization. So this law is very, very important, and I think it's one of the great accomplishments that Gabriela Leite had here in the movement in Brazil. Yes. Some of the challenges of the Brazilian sex work, developing independent sex work programs from governments and policies and their own interests, right? For the same reasons that we're talking about in the stigma, articulating directly with donors so they don't have this middle person so that they can actually advocate for their rights and make sure that the money is coming to be able to help their movement. Second challenge is to develop new sex worker leaders. It's hard for sex workers to step up and say, still with all this beautiful work, to say, hey, I'm a sex worker. You know, there is a lot of stigma in society, a lot of violence that comes with being in the spotlight, with being a woman, with being a sex worker, with being a cis, trans sex worker, for example. So it's very hard to promote these new leaderships. To train sex workers in human rights issues is very important. Disseminate knowledge and understanding of rights-based policies at the local, national, and international levels. And the third challenge is creating a space for legal and policy reform at the national level to combat discrimination and stigma at the parliamentary level. Research and promotion are essential to articulate. So these are some of the beautiful challenges. I have this video here for you. I'm happy to send you this video. This video is just talking about why Gabriela Leite, who is the beautiful woman that is on this video right here, doesn't like when people refer to her as a sociologist. So after she became this beautiful, leader, everybody's like, oh, she's a sociologist, right? Because it's not possible that a sex worker would be a leader. So this is one of the things that she, Gabriela has this way of just dropping the information so neatly on you. And she's so against the political correctness of our word. She says, what is the point of you calling me a sex worker if you're going to still treat me like a prostitute? No, call me a prostitute and have some respect. This is what Gabriela Leite says, right? So she reivindicates the word prostitute, which is something that a lot of different populations from that have been marginalized have used, you know? We have the Afro-American people in the United States, you know, reusing the word with N, you know, for their people to empower themselves. We have LGBTQ community members, for example, queer used to be a terrible thing to call someone, you know, and then the queer community started bringing this word up into their politicization and their empowerment and using it for other people. So I have a couple of minutes left and a very beautiful and long presentation for all of you that can go on forever. And I think I'm going to cut it right here. Because what I want to share with you most today and what is most important for me today is to recognize that by researching directly what sex workers are saying, you know, I have a better understanding of what their needs are. When you are a sociologist, when you're a feminist, when you're a researcher, when you're an academic, there is all this world of idealisms, right? What I would like the world to be like. When we talk about human rights, it's like, oh, human rights for everybody, universal human rights. And we know here today that human rights are not universal. The human rights are not given to everybody just because we are human, but that people have to fight for their human rights. Women have to fight for the rights of their use of their own body. They had to fight many, many years ago in many, many different times in different countries, you know, for the right to vote. People have to fight for representation, you know. Now we fight for a lot of like LGBTQI representation. In different countries, they fight for representation of their African descendants and their African populations or indigenous populations. And what is most important with breaking this paradigm is to understand that as academics and as feminists, my job is not to impose upon another woman what I believe is idealistic so that I can live good with the patriarchal world that I am in, you know? My word is to support my sister. And to support my sister, I need to support what she is doing with her agency, what she chooses to do with the tools that she has. So I believe in that type of sorority towards one another. I also believe it to be an ethical, sociological proposition. I no longer want to be a researcher that comes in a situation and says, oh, this is what's happening there. because especially when I am not a sex worker, you know, I am only a woman and Latina, and this is as close as I get to the Latin sex worker movement. So it breaks the paradigm of this academicism that continuously looks down on people and brings the relationships to be more horizontal. What I am doing here is I'm researching the works and the research, the newspaper, Beijo da Rua, together with a group of different written works that women have done to look at the way that they have empowered themselves through their words and share this with people. And I think that we can learn so much in the feminist movement from this and in general society from this, because it allows us to see that sex work is not just one thing or the other, but it is a vast world where a lot of very unjust things happen, just like they happen in everyday life for a lot of people, you know, but a lot of empowerment and sisterhood and sexual awareness and freedom also happen, right? And I think that our societies, especially in Latin America, where I'm from, where there is so much of this Catholic and religious background that, you know, looks down upon sexuality, this is an interesting way to look at the work that sex workers do to elevate sexuality. And I think that's controversial, and it's very difficult for us to be able to assume it, but I think that difficult tasks are important for us to do, especially as thinkers and as women and as activists and as young people. We should definitely take on the challenge to consider these ideals and consider why they bother us as well. And last but not least, ideally, when I finish this work, I would love to travel through Central America to visit the sex workers organizations in Central America. Central America as an area seems to not have that much of a voice when it comes to academic and research. And we look at other areas of Latin America, like the South or Mexico or even the Caribbean, right? So there is a big space missing of the stories and the realities of sex workers in Central America. And my proposal, pending this in insane pandemic that we are all experiencing, is to be able to let go of the fear and go to Central America and visit all of these women and create workshops where we are inviting women to share their testimonies, to share them writing, to share them via oral, right? A lot of women don't write and read sometimes. So to share them using photography, to share them using paint, to share them in any way that they can and want to share, because I believe those voices are important. They're important for the academy, they're important for policies, they're important for women, and they're important for us to be able to transform into a more equal and just and dignified society. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your presentation and really bringing us into this world, because it is, first of all, such an very, very challenging topic. Like, society most of the time just looks away completely of that, and it's not really like able to speak about this. And especially like when you grow up, like, it's such a taboo to really talk about this and to talk about sex and to talk about everything and that is really related to this. So we consciously chose this topic today to shine light on very, very challenging parts of society as well, and especially related to the Women's Day today. We really wanted to promote you as a feminine leader that is really fighting for voices to be heard all around the world. So thank you so much, and it's really inspiring and interesting to learn more about this. I myself, it's a topic that I haven't really got too deep into, so it's super, super new for me as well. And a first question that came up for me, and probably for many other people as well, is when there is somebody who is working as a sex worker, or perhaps oftentimes, like, unfortunately, it's not their own choice, right? Sometimes there are situations where it's not necessarily a choice anymore, and it's more like the last chance, right? So I was wondering if you have any experiences on how people can basically get support on quitting those jobs again, on like going out of that cycle again, or is there any organization or project that you know that is working in Latin America by providing mental and physical support for those women as well that choose to then like maybe start something else or maybe get out of this forcement, you know. It's just something that came to my mind, and I'm curious if you have experiences with that type of topic as well.
Yes, thank you. That's a great question. I think there's been a lot of organizations, you know, from different types of backgrounds that have come in with the proposal to help women get out of their work, right? And I think most of the research in this organization has been failed. You know, it's been a failed approach. They want to come to women, and then they give women a bunch of sewing machines, and then they want women to become seamstress, you know, and they give women solutions because to a problem that they are seeing, right, without really hearing what the necessities of women are, you know. And this is why I believe that the best way to support the well-being of sex workers, you know, is to support the organizations that they are that they can be part of. So these organizations, you know, which is part of a bigger presentation, they teach women about their human rights. They teach women about, you know, how to manage their money. They teach women about sexual health. They are not scared to assess the realities of sex work today because they are built by those women living those realities, you know? And a lot of these women, for example, in sex work that are part of these foundations have become part of their federal or their local regional governments. So they have become politicians as well, you know, through their mobilization through the sex work organization, right? They are mothers that have children and children that grow up to be academics. We have one of the women that is president of one of the organizations here in Brazil that has that story, right? And I think that the most important is that they receive help with lawyers. They receive help to learn different, you know, abilities, right? From anything from how to type in a computer and have the secretarial skills. And what it goes down to, you know, is to analyze what are the economic realities that certain women are living, right? Because we have sex workers who are escorts now all over the world. You know, I research sex work in Montreal and in Toronto in Canada, you know, and women there are making $1,000 a night, you know, for a couple hours with some guy, you know, and they're getting their mortgage, their university, their car, their vacation in Hawaii paid for. So it's a very different type of sex work that we're talking about, that some women that, you know, live in some other areas of the world where this capacity to do this is not, you know, it's not as possible. It's just not reachable for them to be able to do sex work at that high level of economy, right? So we have a different types of sex work that is on a reality of the world where the economy is not equal, is not horizontal, and is not fair, right? So for us to figure out what is the best way to support sex workers so that they can move out of the life of sex work, you know, which is not a position I take, but it is a position that I understand some people may take. I think that we need to analyze, you know, what are the relationships of economy that are in society, right? Because the problem is so much more bigger than sex work. The problem goes back to even, you know, historical and colonial relations of power, at least in Latin America, right? Of like how many people have come here to take everything somewhere else and how we're always end up with very big debts, right? And the relationships that have created. So it's like, if we just attack sex workers, it's like we want to overlook the problem. So when the problem is so big, I think that the best way is to support the organizations, because those are the ones that are not afraid of the work, that are not afraid of the reality of what's happening, and that are giving women the best tools so that they can protect themselves and move forward, you know? And a lot of the women that are, you know, a spokeswoman for sex work right now, they don't work actively in sex work anymore. They are in other areas, in leadership areas. And this is interesting too, but that was also their choice. And I, you know, I want to respect that.
Wow. Wow. I love this topic as a whole, in relation to the Gaia goals and just like the you know, because ultimately what we're doing with Gaia Protection is like an environmentally focused organization or network of organizations. And it's like this group of women, some of whom, as you said, are supremely empowered. I have friends who are like that. And some of whom are some of the most disempowered, colonized people in the world, you know, it's just have a very difficult lot in their current work. You know, this is like where the rubber meets the road of like colonialism, patriarchy, you know, capitalism, like all of these women, these amazing beings, you know, doing what they need to do to survive under those circumstances. And it's like, yeah, thank you for your work and for your research. My question, I just really wanted to offer that reflection, but my question is, I'm interested if there are different circumstances in Costa Rica. I know that in Jaco, prostitution is legal, and I'm not sure if that extends to other parts of the country. And so, like, you being Costa Ricense, like, what is the realities here in your native country, in my adoptive country?
Mm-hmm. So, well, first I wanted to say that when we talk about why we merchandise life, you know, we merchandise water, we merchandise our trees and our forests, we merchandise our health, which is what makes us live, you know. People buy organs somehow online, you know. It's very easy to understand why we are in a world where you can merchandise everything, including sex, right? And I think that that is a question about where the roots of our society on a global level come from, right? They come from a very big disrespect and ignorance and lack of understanding of the beautiful natural world that we are living in, right? When we, I research a lot of, my second interest in research is ecofeminisms. And, you know, when we talk about ecofeminisms, we talk about the direct relationship between, you know, damaging and violating our Mother Earth and damaging and violating the women in our society. You know, and there's this clear correlation between the two. Now, not all ecofeminists, as well as a very big world of ideas, have this understanding or choose this understanding. But I do, you know, and I see there is very clear, you know, the line between not valuing or not giving the respect and the rights of livelihood to our Mother Earth and to our women. And for me, it connects to sex workers, because I think that, and this is not personal level, it connects to the divine sexuality, you know, and the capacity to create life, you know, and not just life in children, you know, but the capacity to create life through through the energy of our sexuality. So that's my connection there, you know. And in relation to Costa Rica, you know, sex work in Costa Rica is decriminalized. So it's kind of like this gray area, right? And it has its pros and its cons. You know, some of the pros is that technically women are not going to be harassed by the police, or if they come to the police and they say they were raped, you know, technically they are going to listen to their case and be like, yeah, it's possible to rape a sex worker, which is a big issue. A lot of people think it's not possible to rape a sex worker. You know, and they will see and make sure that their rights are protected, you know. The downfall of this, and this is regarding a little bit more of the research I did earlier in my career, so back in 2012 to 2014, you know, is that because sex work is decriminalized in Costa Rica, we have a bunch of women, you know, that come in as migrants, right? And then we have the reds of trafficking of people coming in, right? And then everything falls under the same umbrella. So you have a woman that moved here from Venezuela, you know, and I'm talking about people that I've met, not just coming up with stories, you know, that just came here because she knew that the sex work industry was so good and that she could send money back to her family. And we have people that are living underground from Czech Republic in Costa Rica, you know, that don't speak the language, don't have their passport, and they are in situations of traffic and exploitation for the purposes of sex, you know? And so all of this tends to fall under the same umbrella, and it makes it really difficult to see and to manage how to make this, these things better. But that's why I think if we lose the stigma so much in regards to sex work, you know, we would be able to assess, right, these different situations without fear, you know? Who are people coming into the country that are being exploited, you know? Why is there trafficking of people all over the world? You know, like, how can we actually challenge trafficking of people, you know, at the source, and not damage populations here that could be or could not be connected to trafficking of people, right? Because people come into the countries trafficking cars and, right? So should we attack all the people that are driving cars, or, right? So these things, it's like important questions, and we can see how generalizing makes no sense. But in regards to Costa Rica, it allows me as a researcher to look at these issues a little bit more deeply. I think it protects the women and allows them to do their work. There's still a lot of work to be done at the level of, you know, organizing and protecting their rights, and they do it. They're very active in doing it. The women that are organized, you know, but we also have this gray area that opens up the space for this other world of sex, not sex work. Worlds of sex that come into play.